Shrimed Bhagavad Gita. Shrimed Bhagavad Gita, chapter 6, verse number 4. A very interesting verse. Today we confine to one word, Sarvasankalp Sanyasi. I chose to make it the subject of the day on a pretext, a very important pretext, that at times what happens that in the parlance of ancient Indian wisdom, the scriptures mention certain terms which any mind would land into a confusion that do they have any guidance, any direction, any relevance to my ordinary life? Each one of us, although we are on the journey of evolution and finally we shall all emancipate, but yet different people are at a different platform in the journey towards this final objective of emancipation. And when you are at any given point of time, at any stage within your process of evolution, your priorities are different. And ordinarily, for all of us, our priorities are our worldly objectives. Our worldly objectives are our immediate priority. And the question that suspends before any mind seeking self-development is always the same. How can I accomplish? How can I achieve my objectives? How can I cherish the utmost, dearest vision of my life? And that is something for which one would strive to work and achieve. So, this particular opportunity I have taken in this classroom in order to draw light and direction from this term Sarvasankalp Sanyasi, which otherwise the literal meaning is a renunciant, one who has renounced all resolve. A renunciant who has relinquished all resolves. Okay, let's make it S, not VE. Let's call as Sarvasankalpa Sanyasi. If it means that a renunciant who has relinquished all resolve, then obviously it appears that it has nothing to convey or to direct my life, for the development of my life, to cherish my objectives, my worldly objectives, this has got nothing to contribute. If you probe it deeper, Shrimad Bhagavad Gita, most of the verses, I can say with all liberty, almost all the verses, if not few, they have a direct contribution to the worldly life as well as our spiritual journey that each soul has to mandatorily traverse. Now, what is the message or what is the direction that this word, through this verse numbers 4 under chapter 6, has to contribute or direct our worldly life? There is another word over here, yoga rood, which means one who has embarked upon the path of yoga. What is yoga? Time and again under the live classroom, I have taken the opportunity to explain the essence of the word yoga. And the easiest possible way is to understand it through a mobile phone. A mobile phone is a piece of metal, plastic or certain other materials devoid of connectivity. If there is no connectivity which is associated with the mobile phone on the count of either SIM card or data, that mobile phone shall merely remain an object or a piece of few metals and plastics, nothing more than that. Unless there is connectivity, unless it is able to explore, entangle, hook or come in communion with the vast world outside through connectivity, that mobile phone is an object of non-entity, of no use, in fact, I can say that. And the moment it attains, requires connectivity, it explores a world which is almost limitless today, I can say that. You can access many kind of information through web, and you can also communicate billions of people if you have the numbers and if you are able to communicate to them, probably if you are known to them and they do pick up your phone and respond to you. The idea is to understand only one aspect, and that is that a mobile phone transforms its limited identity into a limitless possibility the moment it acquires connectivity. And devoid of connectivity, it is just a piece, a bundle of few chips, plastic and little bit of metal inside. It's nothing more than that. The connectivity is yoga. We understand yoga through different names: Hatha Yoga, Raja Yoga, that's Dhyan Yoga. Then we say Karma Yoga, Sannyas Yoga, Jnana Yoga. So many kinds of yoga we have. But all the same, they all mean one thing: connectivity. Connectivity of what? With what? Connectivity of the confined one. Connectivity of the limited one with the limitless one. When a connectivity between the limited confined entity is established with the limitless, that particular occurrence is called as yoga. And it should be very clear that all kinds of yoga are ultimately pursuit towards one single objective of acquiring a status of connecting towards the limitless. Under the worldly objective, we can understand that for us, we have our vital worldly objectives that we need to cherish in the form of various resolves. For example, I want to start a business and I am determined for that. I had certain options. I had around 20 options, and out of those 20 options, I have zeroed down to one of them, and I have given it to myself that I am going to embark upon, to cherish, to ultimately manifest this particular objective as my pursuit, and I am prepared to give all in me in order to cherish that objective. Here the word says, renunciant who has relinquished all resolve. How can one have an objective? How can this particular term give a direction to my ordinary life, my worldly objectives, when it has already relinquished all resolve? You are right about that. But we must understand that Shrimad Bhagavad Gita is an encrypted knowledge. There are certain hidden meanings into this. Is not acquiring the path of yoga a resolve? Yes, it is a resolve in its own self. Being on the path of yoga, seeking the final emancipation, in itself is an objective, is itself is a resolve. So what does this word mean? Sarvasankalp Sanyasi, renunciant who has relinquished all resolve. It means one who has embarked single-mindedly on one vital objective and has absolved itself from all other objectives. As I said, giving you a small illustration, that if you have 20 things to do and you factor down to one and make it your prime pursuit and you relinquish your attention from all others, it means that you are a Sarvasankalpa Sanyasi who has focused upon one single objective. You want to start a particular business of a kind, whatever it may be, and all other options, opportunities, you have kept at bay. No, they're not part of me. When you're confined to one, single-mindedly, you stand in the capacity of a Sarvasankalpa Sanyasi. Sarvasankalpa Sanyasi in no way shall mean that you are an entity devoid of any objective. No, it's not possible, because ultimate objective is yoga, connectivity. How can you connect unless you have one single objective? In order to focus and gather all that you have in yourself, in the realms of your time, attention and energy, it is mandatory that you withdraw yourself, you gather yourself from all other distractions. There is nothing left as your priority. There is nothing left there to hinder or to hamper your journey, your pursuit. And this aspect here is termed as Sarvasankalpa Sanyasi. It stands equally whether it is a worldly, a material objective, or it's a spiritual journey of evolution. It stands and means the same for both of them, because in both you have one objective which is higher, which is vital, which you have to cherish to gather your own actualization. When we cherish certain vital objectives of our life, don't we feel as actualizing? Yes, we feel as actualizing. We mark our signatures on our life. We become more meaningful. We consider as a self or of some value that we have been able to traverse. We are able to contribute. We are able to achieve something, accomplish something. There is a difference between accumulation and accomplishment. Accumulation is something which even ordinary minds can do. But accomplishment is for those few who acquire the status of Sarvasankalp Sanyasi, where they exercise the role of a contributant to the world in such a capacity that they feel great pride of being a human manifested on this planet in material form, in physical form. That is accomplishment. And to seek accomplishment, you have to have some objective, whether in the spiritual parlance or in the material world. So, Sarvasankalpa Sanyasi means that you have confined yourself on one and absolved from all other kind of resolve. Anything and everything apart from that one objective is now dissipated for you. It has simply evaporated, disappeared for you. There is nothing left in between you and your one single-minded objective. Because you have to get connectivity, yoga. From a limited entity, you have to expand and become something which limitless can render you. Your own limited stature has to gather a size of a vast entity. This is what it wants to convey when it uses the term Sarvasankalp Sanyasi Yoga Road. If you want to be on the path of yoga, if you want to be on the path of connectivity, it is mandatory for you to absolve from all other resolve. You have to relinquish any and every resolve except one. And it stands the same for any worldly objective. As I said, that I am going to utilize this opportunity of this live classroom in order to see that what light or a direction can we extract, can we extricate from this term Sarvasankalp Sanyasi for our ordinary lives. In the first line, it makes another mention which is very important for us to understand. Indriya artheshu na karmasu anushjate. Indriya artheshu, in service to the sensory drivers, in service to sensory drivers. Any activity, even the minutest one, anushjate. Anushjate has got a word which is anu, A-N-U. Anu means even the minutest, even at the decimated end, the minutest aspect of anything is called as anu. We also use it for the smallest particle. When we have to address the size of the matter to the smallest end of the particle, we say it is an anu. Anushjati, not even connected to the minutest level. Any activity, karamsu, activity, actions. Any activity in service to the sensory drivers, not even at the minutest level, is dispensed by someone who is on the path of yoga, who is on the path to cherish an objective to acquire connectivity. He has to absolve himself and relinquish all other resolve except one. Why was the need for them to say ki they are not in service to the sensory driver even at the minutest level in any and every of the action? It was so because we know the beatitude of the system designed by the Almighty is that we entangle with the world outside through our sensory organs, through our sensory drivers. They gather inputs of information from the world outside and then become an impel inside and drive us through. Whatever we gather from outside becomes our own driver. And be it in form of whether objects, subjects or people, whether it is in the form of object, subject or people, whatever it may be. But one thing which cannot be denied is that all impel that we experience at the end of the mind in the form of a craving or an urge or a drive or an impulse is at the behest of anything that we gather through sensory organs towards object, subject and people. Of course, yes, there are certain impulses which also owe their existence to sanskaras. I am not denying that. But here I am confining my interpretation to what the verse has said. Indriya artheshu na karmasu anushjate. Those who have embarked upon the journey to now connect the limited entity towards the higher entity have to relinquish themselves from all other resolve and have to be at a great caution to observe and put a total restraint upon service to any mandate, impel, urge, craving of the sensory drivers. This message has been conveyed to a special class of people. Who are those people? They are those people who have already absolute clarity about what they want to accomplish in their life. They are the ones who have confusion, dichotomy, dilemma, obscurity. No, they are not the ones. They are the ones who are absolutely crisp, clear. They have absolute clarity about the objective of their own personal life. They know what they need to accomplish. Now they are on the journey. They are on their pursuit. They are traversing ahead. This verse is for them. Because if you have an important objective to cherish, the restraint, the observations of caution, the premonitions that you need to observe has to be of a higher quality. A mountaineer, while moving upwards towards the peak, towards the zenith, has to observe number of premonition, number of restraints. It cannot be with a casual approach that a mountaineer can afford to scale higher. No. While mountaineering, one cannot afford to see all WhatsApp messages. One cannot afford to watch a small video clip each time. One cannot imagine to have a gossip or just to wander. No, you cannot afford to do so. This particular verse, as I said earlier, has to be observed, is for those. And if you are one of them who has absolute clarity, should understand it deeper. If you really want to see things manifest the way you have already planned, designed, then my dear, it is not easy. I know it's not easy. I really know it's not easy, because at time even I become vulnerable to certain distractions which just sway my attention and time and energy, and then I gather myself back with a shake of a head that yes, I have to come back. It is there because the power of the Mahamaya is very strong. If you have already determined a resolve for an important objective in your life, this is for you to take a premonition, caution, and see that the highest degree of self-control is instilled within yourself. Especially at that point from where there is an upsurge of various cravings, urges, and desires. And they are generally related to objects, subjects, people, and at times situations as well. At times it is situations as well. And in service to sensory drivers, you have to ensure that not even the detrimented, minutest, even at the micro level intervention could thwart your energy, your attention, your time, and deviate or deflect you from the pursuit of your path towards connectivity, yoga, from a limited entity to a higher entity. Your objective could be any, whether preparing for some competitive examination or start going for a startup or change of a job or anything that you consider that I can put my life onto that. Something that you're prepared to put your life onto it. For this verse is a great direction. This bears a lot of luminosity for such people. This was enough. And the verse number 4 and 5, the verse number 5 and 6, sorry, in the chapter 6 are going to speak more upon that. They are more vehement. They are more loud unto that. What do they have to say? We'll observe it in the next live classroom of Shrimad Bhagavad Gita, which transpires every second and the last Sunday of the month at 9:30 a.m. Till then, Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Om.